Dear God, we just thank you for this time of worship, that we could come before you and surrender everything that we have. God, we thank you for the Bible. We believe that your word is alive and active. Please help us to remember it when we are worried or fearful, when we need encouragement and inspiration. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, we are awakened by God this morning. Amen. Yeah, it's a beautiful day. We're alive. And we get to worship our wonderful God. And we want to say to you that if you are new here today, or it could be your first time with us, it is just truly, it's beautiful that we get to come to the altar of God with you right now and worship the one and only true King. Welcome to Scottsdale Christian Church, huh? Gets me with such a beautiful Savior. Sing to him. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't he wonderful? Church,
Christ is.
I can't hear you singing. Sing hallelujah. Sing this out with me. Bow down.
arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood.
Father, we want to tell about the treasure we found as this church. God, we are coming before you. We are coming before you and we are worshiping you. We are going to dive into your word. And Father, we can't tell the world of the treasure that we found if we don't read your word. We don't know about Jesus. So today, God, we come before you. We come before you broken. We come before you. Perhaps today is just such a great day. Things are going so wonderful in our lives. Wherever we are, God, may we come and worship you truly by listening to the word that you've put forth years ago. Father, we just lift up Brian now as he reflects on how powerful and beautiful and how much treasure is in your word and in Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, last Sunday, we took a spiritual evaluation. I'll just call it a test. And it was on three major parts. Number one, Bible knowledge, what we know about God and the Bible. Number two is spiritual disciplines, how we act out our faith. And the third part was about Christian character, just who we are as followers of Christ. Now, as we gave that test, I'll tell you what, there's been a lot of reaction this week. Some of it's been bad, but overwhelmingly, it's been really good. And to me, one of the most important parts is this, is that people are thinking and talking about their faith. All week long, people have been doing that. And I think that's fabulous. That's what we want, is to be thinking about God, thinking about his word throughout the week. And so this morning, we're just going to start with a passage of scripture, and we're going to get into some of the stuff from last week. And so if you have a Bible this morning, you can turn to Philippians chapter 2. If you don't have a Bible, there should be one in the chairs in front of you. It's page 831. You can find Philippians on your phone or tablet pretty easily. Or if you brought your own Bible, Philippians is kind of toward the end of the Bible, after the books of like Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, and then Philippians. Philippians 2, and Paul is writing to the church at Philippi. He's talking to them, and this is what he says to them in verse 12. He says, "Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only my presence, now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose." We're not going to go way in depth on this, but I just want to say, Paul is writing, says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. I just want to make sure that you understand, you are not working out your salvation to get a place in heaven, okay? That's already been taken care of through Jesus Christ. When you become a follower of Jesus Christ, that's how you get into heaven, not by your good works, but by grace, by the gift of Jesus Christ. Okay, instead, it's saying that your faith, your walk with God, needs to be something that's continually changing, not just with your outward behavior, but also with your inward character. And God gives us that responsibility to grow and mature in him. But he also gives us the power to grow and to mature in him. He didn't just kind of leave us on our own to do that. He gives us his Holy Spirit inside of us to help us make those changes. Well, this change starts when we study God's Word. When we study God's Word, that's when the change begins to happen. So the Bible knowledge test, just a couple of observations. Number one, some of the most missed questions on the test. There are 100 questions on the test, a couple of the most missed ones. When Paul was on a missionary journey, they're in the middle of the journey and a guy deserted him. The guy that deserted him was a guy whose name was Mark. Also, later on the test, John Mark is his name. John Mark, who deserted Paul on the missionary journey, later became a very great help to Paul in his ministry and later wrote the book of Mark. So, just so you know, that was one of the most missed questions. Another one was this. There was a guy who was giving a speech in front of the Sanhedrin, the Supreme Court of the day. And he was kind of going through the history of the nation of Israel. And then toward the end, he's just like, all right, let me just say it like it is. You stiff-necked people, you're always resisting God. You always resist the Holy Spirit. And the guy who said that was Stephen. Stephen is the guy who said that in the midst of that testimony. And because of what he said, the Sanhedrin, the Jewish rulers, the Bible says they covered their ears, they yelled at the top of their lungs, they dragged Stephen out, and they killed him. And he was the first person that was killed as a Christian. One more. There's just a quote in Scripture. It says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. That comes from the book of Hebrews. So, just for your information, if you want the correct answers, when you get your test back, we circled the correct answers in red so you know. Let me give you some encouragement about this test, okay? Because the number one thing I dealt with was people coming up to me and saying, I'm awful, I'm terrible, I know nothing about the Bible. I'm an awful person, I can't even believe God would even look at me, okay? Let me give you some encouragement. Number one, most of you have never taken a Bible test before. And so you're going to be nervous, you're going to be scared, and that's okay. It's not that big a deal, all right? Number two, this was a hard test. It was intentionally a hard test. When you go to Bible college, the parts of this test were taken from a test they give you at Bible college, where when you go to Bible college, they give you, as a freshman, a Bible knowledge test, and they give you the same test as a senior. And what they want to do is measure your progress over the 4 years. And so parts of this test came from that. It was hard, okay? Stop beating yourselves up for this. Number two, the third thing you need to know is there were about 50 people that took the test and gave us back, okay? Out of the 50 people, only 7 got an A or a B. So it was a hard test. And if I hear of anyone that comes up and says, I'm going to stop going to that church because I'm just not a Christian because I failed the test, I'm coming after you, okay? I'll drag you back here. I'm big enough to do it, okay? But also this, and this was really cool. This is a really cool thing I heard. Some of you may not know all the details about the Bible yet, okay? You're just new to this stuff. But some of you guys are really living this stuff out. I had 2 different women who came to me and said, man, my husband didn't do great on the test, on the Bible knowledge test, but I'll tell you what, he lives out his faith. He, at work, he talks to people about God all the time. As a matter of fact, just recently, he was talking with a guy about God and just said, you know what, you want to bow your head and I'll pray for you? You know, that's awesome. That is good stuff, okay? And so we need to keep in mind and keep a little perspective as we do this, okay? So number one, it's very hard. Don't feel bad about this, okay? On the other side, it should show how much more we need to study the Bible. The average score of everyone that took the test in our church, the average score was a 58 out of 100, okay? And so that's where we are. But remember this, in Romans chapter 15, verse 4, it says this, for everything, it's talking about Scripture, for everything that was written in the past, everything in the Bible that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through endurance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. The Bible was written to teach us who God is, how he wants us to act. The Bible was written to give us hope. I don't know about you, but there are days in my life, there are days, weeks in my life where I need some hope. I need to know it's going to get better. And the scripture was written for us to do that. And so let me go through and help you guys out, because I know that studying the Bible, when I just say you need to read the Bible, I know that that's overwhelming at times. And so I'm going to give you 6 ways that you can study the Bible so that when we take this test again a year from now, you could do better than a 58. All right? All right. So the number one way to start studying the Bible is to read the Bible to review. Read to review. Here's the deal. There are some people that said, give me my test back. Let me see the answers. And they took those tests home, and they started looking up the answers in Scripture to the questions, all of them. Because they said, let's start there. Because at least maybe next year I'll remember some of the questions. They're reading the Bible to review on that test. Okay. Number two, sometimes you need to read the Bible, you read for distance. Okay, and what I mean by that is, instead of just reading just a chapter of the Bible a day, you read maybe the entire book of the Bible in one day. And the reason that you read for distance is to get a big picture of the Bible. My wife says that everybody needs to go through this book. It's reading the Bible in 90 days. As someone who grew up in the church, she knew a lot about the Bible, but when she read it for distance, the whole thing in 90 days, it was a commitment. It was hard, but she was able to see themes of Scripture all happen at once. You know, I did this once. I read the entire book of Mark in one day, and as I was reading through that, I came across this story. It's about Jesus casting demons out of this man. And the man is so excited and so thrilled that he wants to follow Jesus. And as Jesus is getting in the boat, the guy's like, hey, let me go with you. And Jesus says, no, you can't go with me. You need to stay here and tell people what I've done for you. And that always just caught me as just really weird. Here's a guy who wants to go and be with Jesus, and Jesus says, nah, you need to stay here. And I'm like, what in the world? And that's in Mark chapter 5. Well, I was reading through the book of Mark that day, and in Mark chapter 7, I got to a place where Jesus fed 4,000 people. He had just a small lunch or two, just a few fish and a few loaves of bread, and he was able to feed 4,000 people with that little lunch. I'm like, well, that's really cool, but where'd all the people come from? Where did they just show up? And I looked at where it happened, and it was the exact same place that Jesus had left the guy. So when Jesus said, hey, I want you to tell your friends and your family all that God's done for you, Jesus leaves for a while, months or however long it was. He comes back to the same place, and now all these thousands of people want to hear from Jesus because they've seen this guy who had the demons in him, had him cast out, and they see him acting normal. And I'm like, oh my goodness, how cool is that? How amazing is that? Jesus said, yeah, it would be cool to travel with me, but all these people are going to get to know me because you stay here and talk to them. The only reason I figured that out was because I was reading for distance. Okay? Well, there's a third way to read. Sometimes you just read for depth. Read for depth. This is the opposite of distance, all right? This is just taking a little bit at a time. Let me just kind of walk you through it. You just pay really close attention to a small passage or even just a verse, and you really think through that. Today, I'm doing Ephesians 4:1. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling that you've received. Now, you read that and go, oh, okay, that's kind of a cool verse. But to read in depth means this. You take it word by word. Paul writes this passage and says, as a prisoner. A prisoner? What does that mean? It means he's in jail. Wait, Paul, when he wrote this to the church at Ephesus, he was in jail. He was a prisoner for the Lord. He was in jail because of his faith for Christ. As a prisoner for the Lord. The Lord, if you read in your study Bibles or look online on Bible Gateway or something like that, the Lord means master or boss. That's one of the most common phrases to use about Jesus, is to call him Lord. He's in charge. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you. I urge, I compel, I push you, I encourage you. I want you to do this. I urge you to do what? Live a life. Live a life. You know, so many times I don't think we live our lives. I think it's so many times we just kind of just let whatever happens to us throughout the day happen to us. But Paul says, live a life. What kind of a life? One that is worthy. Not just an average, mundane, everyday life, but a worthy life. Worthy of what? Worthy of the calling. It's not the pushing of God. It's the calling of God. It's where he says, hey, follow me. And we either choose to listen to that or we choose to ignore it. Either way, he's calling us to him. Live a life worthy of the calling that you've received. In some fashion today, you have received a calling from God. You're here. See, when you go through a passage of scripture, just a word at a time, and really think through all the meanings of that, man, you get a lot of depth. You get a lot of insight. So it's another way that you can read through the Bible. Another way that you can do it is read about a person. In a Bible study or a concordance or Bible Gateway, Enduring Word, you can just kind of put in someone's name. And when you put in someone's name, just kind of go to every scripture that's in there and just read about that person's life. A quick one of this is what I came across recently. I was getting ready to read the book of 1 Corinthians. And I had some pretty decent background about it, but I was like, what was it about the city of Corinth? What did Paul do there? So I went to the book of Acts chapter 18, and saw that this is where Paul very first started the church at Corinth. And what happened was Paul went to the church, or he went to the city of Corinth, he started preaching, and he did such a good job that the Jewish people there were just mad. They were so angry with him that they took him to court. And they took him to court, and the lawyer for the Jewish people was a guy named Sosthenes. And Sosthenes presented the case to the judge, and the judge said, wait, time out. You're bringing this charge to me to court. It's a bunch of stuff about your own religion. Get this case out of here. I don't want to hear this. And the Jewish people who hired Sosthenes to be their lawyer were so mad, they beat him up right there in the courtroom. And the judge is sitting there watching it, and he could care less. And I'm just amazed. I'm like, oh my goodness. And the book of Acts just goes on. Well, when I read that, and then I started reading 1 Corinthians, and 1 Corinthians says, it says from Paul and our brother Sosthenes. I'm like, what? I went back and read. Yeah, that's the same guy. To the church at Corinth, Paul is writing, and somewhere along the line, this guy who was a lawyer against Paul, somehow Paul connects with him, and the guy becomes a Christian because Paul calls him our brother, and Paul is traveling somewhere and writes back to the church at Corinth and says, me and Sosthenes want to write you a letter. I'm like, dang, that's so cool. And when you read about people in the Bible, you get to read some really cool stories about their faith. Sometimes we can read about a topic. In Psalm 139, verse 13, maybe you want to talk about life and how it begins so early. And so you read in Psalm 139, it says this, "For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." That's just a great picture of a baby inside of his mother. And so you can read a passage like that and read about the joy of life. And there's other passages in the Bible that talk about that as well. Like in Jeremiah, it talks about us being created in and God knowing us inside of our mother before we were even born. So you can go through and study topics in the Bible. And then just one other way, sixth way, you read to review, you read for distance, you read for depth, you read about a person, read about a topic, or read about a word. This is like reading in depth on steroids. All right? And so reading just about a word, in Romans 3:28, it says this, "For we maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from observing the law." And we would look through that and go, okay, I understand most of the words there, justified. What does the word justified mean? Well, justified is a law term. It's a legal term. It just means this. It means I have been found guilty. So like if I was on trial today for speeding, which I have never done in my entire life, but let's just say that I'm on trial for speeding and I'm found guilty. And the judge says, boom, pronounce the sentence, you're guilty. Okay? I've been found guilty, but to be justified means, it means that the price has already...
So whatever fine is there, whatever prison sentence is there that's attached to my crime,
I've been found guilty, but someone else has paid the price that I owed. And so now I'm free to go. I'm justified. It's just as if the price has already been paid. And that's a legal term for us as followers of Christ. We have been found guilty. If you're in this room, you've been found guilty of sin. You have broken God's law. You've been put on trial, and at the end of the day, you're guilty. So, the punishment for that is separation from God forever. It's hell. That's what we have earned. That's what we deserve. But instead, somebody else has already paid that price for us. And so now we are free to go when we accept that payment. That's the great thing about Jesus. It's not that we're great people. It's that he's already paid the price for our guilt. So you go through and read the word justified in the Bible and then go through and read all the places justified shows up. And you can learn a lot about what that word means. All right, so that's a ton of stuff, but it's all about the Bible, right? It's study God's word so that you can learn more about the Bible. Stop feeling guilty for what you don't know and start putting together some type of a plan so that you can grow in your Bible knowledge, okay? Because reading the word of God, that is how we get to know God better, know who he is, but that's only the beginning. As you know more about the Bible, then you have to act on your beliefs. You've got to act on your beliefs. You need to live those out. As a church, most of the scores in the spiritual disciplines, most of the scores were in the sevens, okay? Because that's a really safe number. Basically, people almost never gave themselves below a five. There were a couple of exceptions, but pretty much we've all said that I'm not a 10 in this, but I'm certainly not a 5. I'm not going to fail, okay? I'm a 7. I'm just kind of middle-of-the-road average. It's kind of what we called it. So I wanted to highlight just a few of the things, ones that were 8 or 9 or 10 on average, or ones that we need to work on that were 6s. One of the questions was, I am confident of God's love and provision during difficult times. I'm confident of God's love and his provision. We, as an average, as a church, we got an 8.7 on that. And I think it's great that we would rank ourselves that high, that we believe in a God who loves us and provides for us. One of the other questions was, I give the first 10% of my income to God. That was down in the 6s. So yes, I mentally believe that God is going to take care of me. And I believe that until it comes time to write the check during the week. And then it's a little bit harder. There's Bible reading. One of the questions, I believe the Bible is God's word and provides his instructions for life. 9.9. We believe the Bible is God's word. All right? You know how many tens you have to have an average of a 9.9? A whole bunch. We absolutely believe the Bible is God's word. I read and study the Bible on a daily basis. We got a 6 on that. There's a huge difference between what we believe and what we practice. Here's a cool one on fellowship. I forgive others when their actions harm me. 8.3. We're willing to forgive people for the stuff that they've done to us. On the opposite side of that, I allow other Christians to hold me accountable for spiritual growth. We're not real good at that one. We got like a 6.8 on that. You know, I think a lot of times we still have this independent mindset, this independent streak that you can't tell me what to do. You can't judge me for the stuff I'm doing. And we don't want to be held accountable for these things.
I still remember years ago, a young lady came forward at the end of one of the services and was talking with a counselor. And she was saying, hey, you know, I'm moving in with my boyfriend really soon. And the counselor said to him, well, you can't do that. If you're not married, you can't do that. And the girl never came back. She didn't want someone holding her accountable for her spiritual walk. One of the areas we struggled a bunch with was in sharing our faith. Almost half of those questions, we were in sixes or lower. And when it came to inviting people, it was like a six, inviting people to church services or events. We are working on our side to provide a variety of quality events and services, to have ones that you are proud of, excited about, that you want to invite people to. But there's the other side of it, you know, that you have to be willing to take that step out. And I know it's scary at times. One more. On one hand, I serve other people expecting nothing in return. 8.8. I serve other people and don't expect them to give me anything back. 8.8. You're giving of yourself. That's great. I contribute my time to a ministry at my church on a weekly basis. 6.5. Here's kind of an overall theme was there. And I don't think it's our church. I think it's Christians in America today. I think a lot of people have this belief in God, but we don't do a good job of living that out. But James says this in James 2, verse 17, it says this, in the same way, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by action, is dead. Faith, just to have a mental belief, a mental agreement with something, but no action in our faith, James writes and says, that's not really faith. That's not really there. And John said it in a slightly different way. In 1 John 5, it says this, this is love for God, to obey his commands. If we say that we love God, we show that by the way that we obey his commands. And it's so many times I think that the hardest part to get our faith is the 12 inches from our head to our heart. There's a lot of agreement about God, about his love for us, but getting that into our heart where we truly believe and we truly live it out, that is hard. It's hard. It's one of the biggest transitions in our walk with Christ. But we need to read the word and we need to act on our beliefs so that it will change your character. It'll change your character. To me, the character part of the test was by far the hardest. I mean, Bible knowledge, either you know the Bible stuff or you don't. The spiritual disciplines, either you're doing those things or you're not. But Christian character, that was one I struggled with the most. As a church, the things we struggled with the most, self-control, peace, and patience. I don't know what's wrong with all you people because I'm perfect in those areas. But Romans 12:3 says this. This is something I think is very important for us to get this morning. Romans 12:3, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment. Now, as we get into this last part, understand, I love you. All right? I love you. I'm thrilled that you're here today, but I just want to tell you, we need to think of ourselves with sober judgment, okay? And that means we need to think straight. We need to reason correctly. If you gave yourself all nines and tens, you're probably not looking objectively at yourself. Here's the deal. When I took the character test, I gave myself an average of 8, and I know that that was too high. I do, and I tried to go into it knowing that I think more highly of myself than I ought to. I know that I do that, and I tried to go in and give myself a realistic score, and I know that if my average was an 8, that's too high. The questions and the way that those things are phrased, I struggle with this when it comes to the character. I struggle with it. Am I really like this, or is this what I want to be? You know, I would really, really like to not be envious of my friends when they accomplish some great things. But I struggle with that. I struggle with getting jealous of them when they're succeeding and I'm not as much. And I'll tell you what, as long as I don't talk to them and hear about the things that are going on, I'm not jealous at all of them. Am I like this, or is this what I want to be like? Another part I struggle with, am I really like this, or is this just how I want other people to see me? I talked about this a little bit last week. You know, one of the attributes was kindness. And kindness, I gave the example of holding a door open at a restaurant and letting other people go in front of you, okay? Is that a kind act because I really want them to eat first? Or do I just want the people around me to think, oh, that Brian Leonard, he is so nice? I struggle with, am I really like this, or is this how I want people to think of me? Another character part that I struggle with, am I really like this? Am I like this when things are going well and I don't need it? Or am I like this in real life? It's easy to be patient when you're single. Because when you're ready to go, you can go out the door. When you have a family, a wife, kids, it's harder to be patient because you're put in situations where you have to express your patience. And when they are late, how do you act in that situation? Are you really expressing patience in that thing when you're in the situation? Another question I had in this, am I like this in all situations? When it talks about love is patient, love is kind, love is not self-seeking, it's not rude. When it talks about all those things that love is, am I like that in all the situations or just in certain situations? It's easy for me to not be rude at church. I tend to be on my best behavior. It's easy for me to not be rude at a restaurant. I have a fear of a waiter spitting in my food. Not going to be rude to the guy. It is hard for me to not be rude to the guy who cuts me off. It's hard for me not to ride his bumper when we're in traffic. And the last thing I struggle with as taking the character test is, what am I comparing myself to? Am I comparing myself to other people? Because I tend to look at the best of my intentions compared to the worst actions of my neighbor. And I look pretty good in that situation. When I compare myself to myself, when I compare myself to where I was 15 years ago, I look pretty good. When I compare myself to Jesus, I don't look that hot. Not on a consistent basis. If you don't know how objective you were when you took the character part of the test, I would strongly encourage you. We have a bunch of the Christian character tests out there in the foyer. They're at the welcome podium. There's front and back of those. I would encourage you to give those to a couple people, two or three people, who know you well, who'll be honest with you, who you won't be offended if they tell you the truth. Give them those tests and have them fill them out about you. And then see where you stand. And if they consistently rate you as a 6 and you rate yourself as a 9, maybe we have some mirror issues. Or this, maybe you're pretty consistent on a whole bunch of things. You know, you look at those things and scale it, it's pretty close. But on this, you rate yourself this, and on this one thing, they rate you as this. Now, either they have a problem with you in that area, or maybe you are really gentle at multiple places, but with this person, you're really harsh. And maybe it's a situational thing. Maybe it's a person thing. Maybe you're really kind to a lot of people. There's one person that just drives you crazy. But if you let a couple people evaluate you on those things, it'll give you a much more objective look at who you are. And so we have a bunch of those this morning, and I encourage you to take those. Here's the deal, okay? We took this evaluation, we took this test to get a handle on where we are right now, okay? Now, a year from now when we take this again, my goal is not that everyone aces everything. My goal is that wherever you are now in these areas, that you're a little bit better than you were. And the year after that we take it, you're just a little bit better than you were. You know, that's the goal, that you can look back and go, you know, I've been growing in my walk with God. Well, how have you been growing? Well, according to the test, you know, I had people rate me. I moved from kindness all the way from a 2 to a 4. I'm doing significantly better for me. And that's the goal of these things, is for us to kind of see where we are now, to have a baseline. So a year from now, when we do it again, we can see if we're growing. Now, now, guys, over the next couple weeks, we've got to go through the much harder process. I mean, you thought this was hard. This is just the beginning. The next part is saying, okay, what do we need to change? What do we need to grow in? What do we need to mature in? See, because God expects us to grow. He expects us to change. He expects us to mature. And he doesn't leave us on our own. He gives us the power to succeed. That's what that verse in Philippians was talking about. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. It's God who works in you to accomplish his will in you. God doesn't want you to act like a spiritual baby any more than you want to be a spiritual baby. He wants to help you grow up in him. And so that's what we're going to be doing. And over the next few weeks, now that you kind of get your test and talk about it and stuff, over the next few weeks, we're going to be leading you into a series, a 40-day series, where we're going to say, okay, how do we change? How do we make real, lasting change in our lives? So you'll be hearing about that a little bit more as we go along. But right now, let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you for your word and what it can teach us and how it can expose things in our life. And God, I pray that you'll help each one of us to look at these things objectively, that you'll help us to not be discouraged and not to be egocentric, but that we look and say, okay, God, here's who I am. And I know you want me to grow, and I pray that you'll help me to make those things happen. God, we thank you for your son, and thank you for your grace. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Please stand with us. Hey. We lost our headphones, so I don't know what they did, but here we go. Can tear us from the grip of his mighty love. We only wish his vast affliction could whispers of his heart and passion, his glory. And sends his son lays down his life for all. He lavishes his love upon us. He calls us now his sons and daughters. He's
wide and it covers us. Your love is fierce, your love is strong, it's furious. Your love is sweet, your love is wild, and it's waking hearts alive.
Come on, church, let's sing it one last time. Come on.
Your love is deep, your love is wide, and it covers us. Your love is fierce, your love is strong, it's furious. Your love is sweet, your love is wild, and it's waking hearts alive.
Yeah!
Love is wide and it covers us. Love is fierce, love is strong, it's